It's wonderful to be with you all again and to share with you some highlights from our latest Diocesan Council meeting, which was held Friday, the evening of April 29th, and Saturday, April the 30th. I was attending from home. We were all attending, in fact, on Zoom. I was recovering from COVID and in isolation. So I really didn't chair the meeting, but fortunately our executive director, the Reverend Ann Turner, was able to do that. I did attend and was able to participate as fully as I possibly could, but it was great not to have to be as attentive to the chairing details. So I'm grateful for that. We were led in worship by the South Shore region, and that was a lovely opportunity to commemorate Catherine of Siena on the Friday, and then the next day was sort of a regular day of worship, not a particular commemoration day. After approving the minutes, we shared some updates from various appointments that had been made. So some of the first evening was a little bit of business as usual. We got a number of reports done because we had a piece of work we wanted to do on Saturday morning. So there were appointments to a variety of subcommittees or task groups with the financial management development vision strategy and support team. So you can check those out. We'll share those on the net news so that you can see who's been appointed where. But we've been trying for a while to flesh out a number of committees that some have been a bit dormant through COVID, and some people have stepped away because of other commitments, or COVID has really just affected people's energy levels and ability sometimes, or we've had some people who've, for other reasons, had to step away from that work. So we're glad to have those operating at a fuller capacity. And we also announced appointments for the Anglican Diocesan Center Corporation and acknowledged the retirement of Richard Crowe, who's been leading that organization, the corporation, for quite some time and was really behind, really oversaw the work around the redevelopment to our current structure for the Synod offices. So we're grateful for that as well. We provided, Ann Turner provided an update on the parish of Jollymore with a request from that parish. You may remember, if you follow these highlights regularly, that they had asked the Diocesan Council in October of last year if they could be placed in trusteeship with the diocese so that we could provide oversight as they considered options and kind of consider the future. And since that time, the Reverend Marion Burns has been sort of an interim priest in charge and working with them methodically and carefully. And there has been a group of trustees appointed by me. But the parish felt that they had some renewed energy and had explored some options and felt that they wanted to make some decisions as a parish and felt able to do that, had the leadership available to do that, which didn't seem as clear before. But they were quite willing to do that. And so we agreed, there was a motion to allow them to withdraw from the trusteeship process. So they will now be going through the final stages of that with the trustees providing a final report and reinstating the parish council to its full power and capacity. And then we'll look at other decisions with them in due course. There was an update on our Diocesan Synod, which is happening in October at Dalhousie University, Student Union Building, as we've had before. There are some changes, as we've noted before, in that this will be a Friday evening to a Sunday. So that's a change from the most recent synods, although that was a pattern that we used in the past in this diocese. And the theme is we shall all be changed. So we're going to be reflecting on some of the ways that COVID has changed us as individuals, as members of society, as Christians, as members of churches, how it's changed the shape and the look of the church, and how it's transformed how we function in community and with one another. So that'll be interesting to hear more about, and there'll be details coming out soon to all of the delegates, and there'll be regular updates as details start to fall into place for that. We had some other reports in the evening. We shared a little bit from a report from Ann Turner, just thinking about where we go from here. We we shared some sort of a timeline with folks around the resignation of our financial controller, Chris Veach, and just the various events that took place and what we've been doing as a diocese to just put procedures in place to make sure that we could continue the financial work of the diocese. So there were no issues with his resignation. There was an opportunity that he had in another area that seemed to him worthwhile to pursue. So we parted on good terms and just really had to think about where we go from here to continue some of that work. And so some of that work involved moving towards Office 365 as a diocese, which we're doing carefully and thoughtfully and in time, not slowly, but not quickly either, taking our time to learn about that and to find out what benefit it affords us as a whole diocese to enable parishes to have some benefits as well to accessing resources. So we have some pilot parishes that are helping with that, and we all in the diocesan office are moving to SharePoint to a way to store files that will be a little bit easier. That means they're kind of resident in the diocese and moving to some different patterns around email addresses and such. But you'll be updated on all of that in due course. There'll be good communication before changes happen. So hopefully no surprises for anybody, and it shouldn't really affect anything you're seeing right now from communications in the Synod office. We have, we did meet the next day on Saturday, we did meet our new acting financial controller, Eugene Vandenberg, and he was working on a part-time basis to make sure that we continue to do the work that is necessary to fulfill all of our financial obligations in various ways. Peter Fleming is assisting in terms of overseeing the audit, so that's a piece of work Peter takes on. And others in the office will continue to do the work that they normally do, Patrick and Tammy, around processing of accounts and payables, and for Tammy, all the payroll stuff. So things seem to be working really smoothly, and I think people are finding, I guess, a new groove in terms of how to work together and just getting to know each other and clarifying the various tasks of who's doing what. And so Eugene's doing some great work around the budget as well, which has been really helpful for us to see. We also talked about where we go from here in some other ways. Just thinking about as we emerge from COVID, we've noticed some changes, and this is something I've heard at the House of Bishops across the Canadian Church, that you know we're all finding that as we come out of this and as we've had less time to be in person with one another and in community in particular ways, that we want to take some time to sharpen some communications tools and skills. We're finding that there still is some stress and anxiety, and sometimes that comes out in different ways in terms of how we interact with one another. So we introduced that, and then I'll say more in a few minutes about some work we did the next day with Mike McKenzie, who chaired the communications task force a while back for our diocese, for diocesan council, and shared some work with us that next day. But just to kind of point out that was work we thought we needed to do. We continued on Saturday, and we really began the day with that communications workshop with Mike. And so Mike led us in a process of really looking at what has changed in the area of communications, like what are some things we've noticed that are different. So we talked about the impact of email communication, the 24/7 kind of way we seem to be available to one another through these instant ways of communication, email and texting and such. And some of the challenges, the anonymity sometimes that provides, that when we're not talking to people face-to-face, whether it's over Zoom or in person, that sometimes we can't detect tone. So someone might send off an email hastily, and they may not mean it to sound blunt, but it may appear that way. It may not have been intended that way. So all of the ways that communication cues can get missed because of the method of communication, the ways that in Zoom we can't necessarily read body language the way we can if we're in a room with other individuals. So we talked about the need to kind of work on that. And Mike led us through a process of trying to define and clarify a sort of vision or approach for communications in the diocese. And this would be the way we want to be communicating with folks in the diocese, clergy, parishes, leaders, parishioners, and how we want people to communicate with us. So it really was talking about values. What are the things we value? We talked about being respectful. We talked about anticipating timely responses. We talked about all kinds of ways that we could really listen and lean in and hear what the needs are and try to respond faithfully to those. So it was a good working session, and that information will be shared more fully once it's in a form that that makes it a little bit easier for us to do that, because it will be something that will inform our steps going forward. And we continue to work on communication. It continues to be something we hear about as a stress and a frustration for people, and just remind people of all the staffing changes we've gone through in the diocese. And of course that affects communication as well, but we have addressed that in a variety of ways. So we do have someone who's in the diocesan office 4 days a week now, Sarah Slopek, who is answering the phones and redirecting email and other communications as needed. So hopefully at least you can call and there's someone on the other end of the phone, which for a while there wasn't necessarily. So hopefully that will help to get people to the person or the resources that they need when they call the office. We've also created a new, Ann Turner has created with the finance team after a conversation with them, a new email account called info.finance or finance.info, I'm sorry, I think it's info.finance at the usual diocesan address, but that's been shared over the Net News, I know, as well. And that is something that you can use if you have a financial question, you're not sure who to direct it to. In fact, unless you know who to direct it to, we really want that to go there so that we can determine who on the team can best answer your question, can best respond to the inquiry and get you what you need, so that there's not frustration with something perhaps going to the wrong person, then having to redirect things a number of times. So there's been a lot of work to try to streamline how communications works in the office, and also just the financial pieces to be clear about, that we understand fully who does which pieces, so that we're directing the right things their way and not sending things that don't really belong in their area of work or portfolio. So that was a productive conversation. We also spent some time, Anne advised us that there had been work to evaluate the vision, strategy, and support teams. And some of these groups may have been doing this work all along, but many really hadn't stopped to take the time to look at what they're doing, what's working well, what has changed since COVID. I mean, this was certainly the first time they'd looked at that. What has changed, and how has COVID impacted the ministry and the work that they do? In some cases, it's made them it's made it much easier because people can gather more frequently, or certainly at least in greater number because they don't have to travel. So that's been a big plus in some of the VSSTs where it's meant they can get fuller participation. Some groups have found that they've had to streamline the work they're doing because COVID has encouraged them to pivot to provide resources in new ways. And that's why I know the Creating Missional Communities VSST has done lots of Zoom sessions with various folks facilitating in a number of key ministry areas to try to equip people to think about how they do ministry and give them some tools and skills and tips. So there've been lots of ways that there've been changes, and this was a way to reflect some of this, but also to give us important feedback as we look into further towards strategic planning for the diocese and what are our current needs, what are some things that are emerging, what is some work that's been completed that can be laid down, and what are some new initiatives or opportunities or challenges that need to be picked up, and where do they fit best. So the evaluation is just a time to take stock and really consider what we've been doing and where God is calling us now and what God is calling us to do now, so that we don't simply have committees and groups just for their own sake, but they are for the people involved, fulfilling, and they have a sense of purpose and direction and contribute to the wider vision of the diocese and support our parishes and clergy. So that's been, I think, really a good work. We were updated on the various committees and the various staff folks. And actually, it was Friday night, we had a report from the Youth and Family Ministry Coordinator, Alec Hulp, and a video a video report, which is lovely. And Ali talked mostly about some of the work that's been been done towards the day camps, the community roots day camps that are happening this summer. And those are happening in a variety of communities across the diocese, one in Prince Edward Island, on Prince Edward Island, and the others will be taking place in Nova Scotia. There have been two program architects hired in our diocese, and they're working in our synod offices now as of the 1st of May. And they are the ones who sort of construct and develop the camps, the format, the structure, the content, with input from the various folks where they're going to be leading those camps and other folks who have expertise in that area. And also there was a program coordinator. So there's somebody hired in a role to oversee that whole those camps and that work that's being done. So that's exciting. It's brought some new life and energy as well into our diocesan offices to see folks at work on those, and to think about ways we can continue to animate and breathe new life into youth and children's and family ministries across the diocese, which we know have been hit hard by COVID. In some places, families who had traditionally been participating have stepped away. And so this is an opportunity for young people to reengage with the church, whether they attend church or not. So to reengage or to engage for the first time, for people to come with their friends and to learn something that's going to be hopefully enjoyable and helpful for them. So there were some good things happening with respect to the youth and family ministry portfolio. Lisa Vaughn in the Parish Vitality Coordinator's report shared some information about her ongoing work in parishes with helping guiding them through mission action plans, the continuing work she's doing in the National Church to focus on congregational development, helping parishes through regular podcasts to learn more about various initiatives in ministry with a variety of speakers addressing topics that are of interest in a whole bunch of areas and pursuits. So lots of good stuff happening there, a summer book club coming up. So, and again, she spoke a bit about the work of the Creating Missional Communities, BSST, as did another member who was present, Tanya Moxley. One of the things that emerged through the Creating Missional Communities report was a question around supporting parishes that might be interested in the redevelopment of their parish properties. So we have seen this in a few areas. Of course, our own diocesan center is an example of a major redevelopment, but we recognize that in some parishes there may be some interest in looking at this, but not really a sense of how to go about it or what would be involved. So we've tabled that until the June meeting so that we can get some more information and talk a little bit further, but we'll be looking at that. You know, how do we consider how we support parishes as they look to the possibility of repurposing or co-purposing their building? So it's moving away from simply renting space to people to thinking about probably a more radical or transformational approach to the building and how it could be shared in different ways with community partners. So that's something that's on their agenda and something they're interested in pursuing. And it's actually been something that's been part of their work for a while now, but it seems to be getting some new life in the last little while. We heard a little bit from the refugee coordinator about her work, Elizabeth Peter, and the challenge in the backlog of refugees coming to Canada. So we were encouraged to find ways to support or encourage the government to move forward more quickly on addressing that backlog, because there certainly are people who are waiting a very long time to bring refugees into the country and to support them. A lot of our refugee sponsorship are through family arrangements, families who have people who have family members that they want to bring here, and they're already settled here. We support them by offering work through our sponsorship agreement holder arrangement with the federal government. But we also have parishes who are involved in refugee sponsorship as well. And so Elizabeth's role is to facilitate that. And we've applied for Each sponsorship agreement holder gets a certain number of places that they're allowed to use, a certain number of refugees or family groups that they're allowed to offer to sponsor. And so that's something that's in progress now. So we're waiting to have all that finalized. We looked at an application for the Anglican Foundation from Summerside, from Parish of St. Mary and St. Eleanor, looking for a new roof. So we were happy to approve that and forward it on to the Anglican Foundation, which doesn't necessarily mean it'll get funding, but it means it's one of the requests or applications that we're recommending. So we hope that they'll be successful in that application for funding through the Anglican Foundation. We also heard a little bit about, in my report, I shared a little bit about the recent House of Bishops meeting and some of the work we're doing. I mean, we're working now towards preparations for Lambeth in summer. I also just talked about some of the challenges that we are facing in light of the resignation of the National Indigenous Anglican Archbishop, Mark MacDonald, and some of the work that's been happening around the ACC2 movement at the Anglican Church of Canada. So for a long time, our diocese, before I became elected bishop, before I was elected, there was work to revise our sexual misconduct policy. So that work is continuing, and we will be bringing a draft revised policy to Diocesan Council in June. And for a while, we've been talking about the need to look at trauma-informed approaches, like how we address complaints that come to us, how we respond to complainants, how we care for people, for all people through this process, the complainant and others who are involved in this process. And so we've taken our draft policy and we shared it with folks who do this kind of work in ministry in other places. So one of those places is King's College with the sexual health and safety officer there, who's given us some feedback. And we found a few other folks as well who are connected to our church and parishes who do this kind of work and can give us some feedback and provide that sort of lens through which we can look through our policy and say, you know, are we being responsive? Are we being sensitive? Are we being, you know, does the policy do the kinds of things it needs to do? So we've vetted it in those kind of ways so that we have that feedback before we bring it to council. And we're also planning a series of workshops. It will really be a workshop for active clergy. Hopefully they'll all be able to attend one of the dates that we've chosen. But those are going to be led by the sexual health and safety officer for King's College, Jordan Roberts. And those will be as well looking at what we hear about this trauma-informed approach. So we haven't settled on a title for these yet, but it really is about how we help when we're in situations where we're responding to people who've experienced trauma. And that can be trauma in a whole bunch of, that's not simply to look at sexual abuse or sexual misconduct, but you know, we often as clergy and anyone working in front lines with people will experience people who've had an episode or an incident of some kind of trauma. So how is it that we can, how do we listen? How do we ask good and thoughtful and appropriate questions? How do we check in to care for people? So it really will be hopefully just building another piece of our skill set and our sensitivity towards some of these situations that we find ourselves in. So we spent some time with that and just talking about the need to do this work. And that it's ongoing work in the church that we've been engaged in for quite a long time in this diocese. So it's just taking those next steps and determining what some of those new practices or best practices are, and trying to ensure that our policies and procedures really kind of fit with that, with the research that's there now and the knowledge we have and the tools that are available to us. So that was that seemed to be well received, to have just some open conversation about some of that. Trying to think where we went from there. There really was we had updates on some of the reports, but those are really I think the highlights from our time together, it felt really, really great. Again, we had worship led by the South Shore region in that morning, and ended up powering through lunch so that we could end a bit early and enjoy the day. But it was a great day together, and I think just really helpful to be thinking about the way ahead for the diocese and how we come through this time living with the pandemic for the past 2 years, knowing that we're not out of the pandemic yet, that we still have a way to go. But that we want to emerge in a healthy way, not just healthy, physically healthy, but as a diocese and as parishes, we want to do our best to have learned something and to become stronger. And we want our parishes not just to sort of survive through this, but to thrive and to flourish. So we're continually looking at what we can do to support, enable and equip clergy and parishes as they come through this. With ways that are going to help them in the months ahead. Oh, it was a very productive and full session of Diocesan Council, and we were glad to be there. And as I said, I was glad to have someone else chairing so that I could be there and present, but didn't have that that full responsibility. And it was great to be together, and look forward to meeting in June. We'll have a full agenda then as well, with some key things on our plate to look at. But you'll hear more and see more through the net news and possibly through the Diocesan Times.